Hello, I'm Jen Storer, children's author and chief inspirationalist here at girlandduck.com, and I have just come out of Duck Pond Office Hours. So Duck Pond Office Hours is a monthly thing. It's a get-together that we have on Zoom for members of the Duck Pond, which is my online membership site. And once a month, I come in and do a live call. And we shoot the breeze, ask questions, talk about what we're doing, all that kind of stuff. So it's really lovely. The first Thursday in every month we do it. But, sorry, the cat's been in here. I've got itchy nose. So I had some questions in office hours this morning that are questions that I have had over and over and over and over across the years since I've been doing Girl and Duck. And so I thought, well, I've still got my lippy on. And before I go down the rabbit hole of working on my new junior fiction series, which is what I'm planning to do for the rest of today, I thought, you know what, I'll make a YouTube video about this because I haven't made a YouTube video for a while. I've noticed a few new subscribers, and I'm more than happy, trust me, more than happy to go over the same questions over and over again, because as newbies come in, they want to ask these things. And also people who've been around the traps for a while sometimes need to hear these things again. And the longer I'm in the trade, the more I know about these things too, and the more I can share, all right? So that's why I'm happy to go over these questions again. So let me start here. I've got my papers here. So the first question that I really want to have a little chat about is from, well, I won't say who it's from, will I, because it's private. But anyway, I'm a first-time children's writer, and I know traditional publishing takes quite some time. What do you see as the pros and cons of traditional versus self-publishing? All right, what do you see as the pros and cons of traditional versus self-publishing? Okay, this is a massive question, and it's something that's on the mind of a lot of newbies as they come into this industry, particularly if they've tried the traditional route, you know, first up and then discovered how difficult it is, because it is difficult. Doesn't mean you can't do it. There's a difference. It is difficult and it is time consuming. And so a lot of people think they'll self-publish, all right? But then they come up against, well, what's involved with self-publishing? And this is the thing. Now, one of the things I want to put out there is I am a traditionally published author and have been for my entire career. So I am not, by any stretch of the imagination, a guru in self-publishing, all right? I barely know anything about it in terms of its details. All I know is what I've heard across the years, and all I know is sort of like from the perspective of traditionally published author, you know, that's what I can give you. So I sometimes say I'm actually the wrong person to ask in this case, but I can shed a little bit of light on it. And what I want to say to anybody out there who's thinking about foregoing traditional publishing simply because it takes too long, all right, if they're thinking of foregoing the traditional publishing route, then there's a few things that you need to ask yourself and you need to realize. When you self-publish, it's not just about the work, all right? What are you trying to get out of this? That's the thing that you need to ask yourself. What am I trying to achieve with this book? Now, if you are just wanting to publish a dear little book that's your own love project that you can share with a few of your friends and family, and that's your goal, then go right ahead and self-publish. I have an artist friend who recently did the same thing and got a lot of joy out of it. Okay, he produced a beautiful book. But you know, it was basically a small print run just to showcase some of his work in that format. However, if you want to have a career as a publisher, or if you're trying to make money out of writing books and children's books, then you need to think hard about self-publishing, because self-publishing comes with some fairly big problems and challenges, and they're not about the creation necessarily. That's hard enough in itself, though. And trying to do it on your own without, you know, the expertise of a publisher and a group of editors behind you can be pretty, pretty hair-raising. But that aside, what's tricky is the marketing and distribution. How are you going to get your book under people's noses if that's what you want to do? If you want to get your message out there to as many people as possible, or if you want to make money out of books, then how are you going to do that? How are you going to get them out there in the volumes that's needed in order for you to reach, you know, lots of people, get into libraries, all that kind of stuff? How are you going to do that? Think about that, research that, and decide, am I up for that? You know, have I got the wherewithal to go the full distance, to not only create and edit and print this book and have the vision for it, but also to market and distribute it? Okay, so that's what you should be researching, and that's what you should be thinking about. And that's why I strongly suggest to anyone who's thinking of going the indie route or the self-publishing route to get to know other authors who've done it, or at least, you know, get onto blogs where people have done it and talk about it in depth, because you really need to know what you're getting into before you go in. Do your due diligence if you're going to self-publish. All right, so that is what I can talk about in terms of the pros and cons. It's not an easy ride. Neither way is easy. I think the traditional publishing route is easiest. Out of the two most difficult options, I still think that the traditional way is the easiest, because you've got, once you do get a foot in the door, you're surrounded by experts, okay? And experts who know what they're doing in fairly complex arenas. And that's who you need behind you if you're trying to reach lots of people and lots of readers and really give your book a good lifetime. Now, I want you, if you're new, to go down to the videos here, to the In Conversation videos, and I want you to listen to watch my interview with Michael Earp. I'll link it again at the bottom of this video. Michael Earp was Bookseller of the Year last year in 2021, and has a wealth of experience in the children's book industry and in the book industry in general. Even if you're not writing children's books, but you're still watching this out of curiosity. His take on what it's like from a bookseller's point of view, all right, when indie authors are trying to get their books into your shop, and the complexities around that. It's not straightforward, all right? You don't just go in and plonk your book down and ask them to sell it, or plonk a box of their books down. They're working with publishers and reps, and they've got limited shelf space, and they've got authors who already have bodies of work and reputations, and their books are going to be easier to sell, and they don't know you from a bar of soap. Okay, so see what I'm getting at? There's all these things start to creep in when you self-publish, and these are things that you need to think about. Again, I'm not saying don't do it. There have been some people who've had great success and have kicked off big careers via self-publishing. I'm just saying go into it with your eyes wide open. That's all. You know, do your research, think about it. So go and have a look at that video with Michael Earp, and you'll learn some more stuff about the self-publishing route. All right. The next question was about, that I really wanted to talk about, was not that one. Because we went through that one really deeply, but I didn't want to talk about that one on YouTube. What was it? That's right. Picture books. In the Duck Pond at the moment, it is picture book month, which means we're not just only talking about picture books, but we are giving a mighty, mighty love to picture books this month. We are really, really celebrating and enjoying picture books and their presence in our lives and the lives of our children and the lives of those around us. Our history with picture books, you know, we're just, our timeline is covered in PBs and PB anecdotes and lots of sharing around picture books. And earlier this month, we had a live Q&A in Zoom with Tren Bing, who is currently head of children's publishing at HarperCollins in Australia. And so we had a direct Q&A with her, and we learned so much about picture books and publishing picture books and all that stuff behind them. And then later in the month, we're also having a masterclass with Andrew Joyner, who is an extraordinarily talented picture book author and illustrator. There's one of his books from recent times, Love Was Inside, published by Random House in the US and Canada and Australia, of course. So Andrew Joyner is going to be joining us to give us a masterclass on the creation of picture books as well. And then at the end of the month, when all that's said and done, I will also be running my four-week course, 4 weeks to write a picture book. Okay, that's a separate course that anyone can join and come along and for the ride and learn, you know, the ins and outs and nuts and bolts of writing a picture book over a course of 4 weeks with me. Now, so that's all going on in the duck pond, but somebody wrote in this morning, or somebody put in the comments in the Q&A, they asked a very basic question that plagues a lot of first-time authors. And again, this is why I wanted to do this on YouTube as well. And that was, they wanted to know, is there a standard format for submitting picture books to publishers? Is there a standard format for submitting picture book manuscripts to publishers? And my short answer is, yeah, there is. Okay, it's not a standard that, you know, you must meet and they won't look at it if you don't meet that standard, but it's an industry standard, all right? So when you're submitting a picture book manuscript to a publisher as an author, I'm not talking to illustrators here in particular, I'm just talking to authors, then you need to paginate your story, which means break your story up into, you know, what text is going on what page. That's what paginate means. Just paginate it. Now, this means that you're going to have to decide how many pages your picture book is going to be. Again, hear me on this and hear me on this. This is not set in cement, all right? Don't think that because you've paginated your story in a 32-page format that you're locked into a 32-page format. All right, this is just for ease of presentation. It's for the editor's ease so they can see the story laid out and see how it might work. This is not a contractual thing that you're committing to. So you do need to, at the beginning, before you submit your manuscript, you need to decide, is this a 24-page book or a 32-page book? Or indeed, maybe a 48, but I always work with 24 and 32. All right, especially for newbies. If you're trying to get your foot in the door, just go gently, all right? Go for the most standard, all right? And 32-page picture book is bulk standard, all right? But 24 pages is acceptable too. Let's get that out there. See, there's all these nuances. It's just such a tricky industry. Anyway, so that's what you'd be doing. And all you would be doing is putting it into a Word document. You just submit it as a Word document and you just put page 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, thinking about double page spreads, all right? And always keeping in mind that the first 1 to 2 pages of a picture book generally have nothing on them. They have, not nothing, they have imprint page and a title page, sometimes a semi-title page. So a picture book, actually a 32-page picture book, doesn't usually start until page 3 or 4. Now go to your little library, your little shelf at home, or to the library and get out a stack of recent PBs and have a look at them and see how they're laid out. Count the pages and see what's on what page. All right, but that's the main thing to remember, is that a picture book doesn't start on page 1. It starts on 3 or 4, usually. So when you're putting your text into that Word format, that's what you're thinking about. It's about showcasing to the person that you're submitting to that you understand this procedure and you understand this flow. And indeed, when you do go to paginate your text, you will see little flaws and hiccups in the story as well. They'll become more apparent to you because you're actually putting it into this format. You're taking it out of it, just a conglomeration of paragraphs, and putting it into this actual picture book format, which has an effect on how the story is read. It has an effect on the pacing, and it definitely has an effect on how it's illustrated. Right, so this is what you're thinking of, but it is just a Word document. Now, one more little aside, please avoid as much as possible illustration suggestions and illustration notes. Please avoid them unless they're really important for clarity, unless it's completely, utterly ununderstandable without a tiny little illustration note. Do not put illustration notes all over your manuscript. The publisher wants to see the text. All right, because the publisher is, if you sign up, the publisher then is the main source of creation, and they will be thinking about the market, and they will be thinking about who's best suited to illustrate this book and who they want to contact. And if they're excited, they'll be going, oh my god, this book would be so awesome with, you know, Andy Joyner or Caroline Magerl or Lauren Child, I don't know, anyone. All right, okay, they're thinking about who they want to publish to illustrate the book. And it's not your job to select that person or to tell that person how to do their work and what they should be illustrating here. So that's actually a whole other video, which I could go a lot deeper on. But at the point of just formatting your text to submit to a publisher, these are the things that you need to think about. It needs to be clean, needs to be pretty much free of illustration notes and suggestions, and it needs to be paginated, and it needs to be in a Word document. It needs to be, hear me, less than 500 words, please. If you can, please listen on that one. First timers, all right? I'm talking to first timers who I'm trying to get across the line. Don't scare publishers by giving them, you know, 800 or 900 words and say it's a picture book. All right? Don't scare them off. Stick to the traditional gold standard. Now, why have I got these picture books in front of me? Oh, I just have, because they're really beautiful picture books, and I just wanted you to see them again. And I, you know, get these sorts of picture books out and have a look at them, and have a look at how they are paginated. See what's on what page. All right. And then think about your text in terms of that. And you will see that this is my picture book that I did with Andrew Joyner. You will see that there's differences and nuances. And so that can really confuse you. So just hold on to that. Okay, I'm going to work with 32 pages. Okay, I'm going to work with 24. And this is how I'm going to paginate it for ease of reading for the editor. I'm not locking myself into anything here, and it doesn't have to be utterly, utterly perfect or anything like that, but it does have to be laid out nicely. Something like piano fingers. Go and have a look at my In Conversation with Caroline Magerl. You'll learn heaps from that as well. I'll put a link to that down below as well. So these are just some tips on how to write picture books, especially when you're new to it. Honestly, we're all new to it every time. Every single book we come to is a new challenge, and we're always learning in this industry. Then that's another thing that you will find the longer that you're in here. Again, I just wanted to say that I will be running my 4 weeks to write a picture book course with Jen Storer. I'll be running that next month. That's May 2022. So if you want to know about that, if you wanted to be invited along to do that course, then please join my mailing list. All right, I'll put the link to that, because YouTube, I'm not very reliable on YouTube, but I am right across my mailing list, and I write to my people at least every two weeks. Just to say hi and keep in touch. I write what's called newsletters. So there's lots of tips and love for the children's book industry and children's books in general, lots of that and inspiration. And kitties, my house, my tree change. They're sort of personal letters, but they're fun. And then I'll send you the occasional ad, for want of a better word, of what's going on in Girl and Duck, what courses I'm offering, when the duck ponds open, all that sort of stuff. But I won't slam you or spam you or wham you, all right? I'll just keep in touch and let you know what's going on. That's all from me now. I need to go and do some work. I have spent my whole morning chatting to people about writing and not actually writing. I love procrastinating. procrastinating. All right, I have to go. Thank you so much for watching, and I will see you next time I pop up on the tubes. Okay, bye.